So in this video, we're going to look at different type of financial intermediaries. Generally speaking, we have three different kinds. So the first kind we call depository institutions, such as the commercial bank. So what's the characteristic of the depository institutes? So we refer to this kind of institute as banks throughout this text. So there are financial intermediaries that accept deposit from individuals and institutions and make loans. So which means they gather the actual money for people who have gathered the money from people who have actual money and lending them out to people who need money. And so generally speaking, we have four different kinds of deposit institutions. So the first one is a commercial banks. Like I said, the PNC Bank, the JP Morgan Chase Bank, so they're all considered as the commercial banks. So what is the characteristic for the commercial banks? So for the commercial banks, so they raise funds primarily through issuing the checkable deposit. So that's why you have a check from the banks. And also they raise funds through saving deposit. So you can put 5, 10 years. You have saving account with certain bank. So that's how they raise the money. A third possible way is called a time deposit. So that is deposit with a fixed term or maturity. So you have to put in the bank for, let's say, 5 years. It's different from the saving deposit. So saving deposit, you only have limited in terms of how many time in a year you can withdraw the money from a saving account, but you definitely can withdraw any time. However, if you talk about the time deposit, 5 year, 10 year, you have to put your money in that for 5, 10 years. You said, how about I just don't want to put 5 years? So then you won't be able to get a promised interest. So you won't get promised interest. So you might as well trade your 1 year as a short-term deposit. So sometimes you won't even get any interest out of it. And so after they receive this kind of fund, raise the fund, they usually will make the commercial, consumer, and a mortgage loan and to buy the US government security and municipal bonds. So that's how they're going to use the raise the fund to funding the business and sometimes do a little bit of investment. And so in American, so far, generally speaking, we have about 5,000 commercial banks. Oh, it's a lot. And so the second type of the depository intermediary is called a saving and a loan association, LS, and mutual saving banks. So first of all, I want to see that nowadays when you go outside to look at those kind of association, key banks in Pittsburgh, so actually we'll find that they are very similar as our commercial banks. So we have about 1,000 saving and loan associations or mutual saving banks. So what's the main difference? First of all, for this kind of institutions, so they don't have time deposit. So for a commercial bank, they do offer time deposit. The saving loan association, mutual saving banks, they don't offer the time deposit. And usually they're using the money to funding the residential housing. So that's the main difference. But as I said, nowadays, those differences, the regulation on the saving and the loan associations and mutual saving banks got loosened. So you won't see that a clear boundary between the commercial banks and the saving and loan association and the mutual saving banks. So the third type of the depository institution is called the mutual saving banks. It's called a credit union. So in the United States, we have about 6,000 credit union. So they are typically a very small cooperative lending institution organized around a particular group. So like labor union and the employee of the particular firm and so forth, they will have the credit union. And so they acquire from deposits. As I said, it's belonging to the depository institution. So that's why they would acquire funds from deposit. And usually we'll call those deposits as a share and primarily make the consumer loans. So those are then the last one. Now, so those are the different type of the depository institutions. So this is the first type. So the second type of the financial intermediary is called contractual saving institutions, such as life insurance, fire and casualty insurance, and pensions, government retirement funds. So how they require the funds. So all of them require funds through premiums of the policy. So premium of the policy. And also comparing with the depository institution. For the contractual saving institutions, they don't need to worry about they need the liquidity, because the premium you pay, you won't ever get it back. Unless you have accident. But if you don't have any accident, and so those premium is paid. So for those kind of contractual saving institution, they know they have the funds for sure for a long time. So that's how they usually invest their fund, is in the on the capital market. They're gonna purchase the corporate bond and buy the mortgage and buy the municipal bonds and buy the stocks. So that's how they usually invest, because they don't need to worry about the liquidity. And so obviously based on name of different kind of the insurance, so life insurance, they are you purchase it to against the against the financial hazard following a death or sell annuity. So for the fire and casualty insurance, so you purchase those insurance to against the loss and theft, loss from theft, fire, and accident. So which means if you don't lose your life, if you purchase this kind of insurance, if you don't have any accident happening, your premium won't ever coming back to you. And the third one is the pension fund, the government retirement fund. So for this kind of fund, as I said, this is provide retirement income in the form of annuity to employees who are covered by the pension plan. And again, for this fund, both you and your employer will contribute to this fund. And since this is a no liquidity issue, so the pension fund and the government retirement fund usually invest the money they acquire in a corporate bond and a stock. So this is the second type of financial intermediaries. And the third type of financial intermediary is called investment intermediaries. So the first one is called finance companies. And so they acquire funds through commercial papers, through the stock and the bonds. So they issue the commercial paper, stock, or bonds. And so they're using their money to giving the commercial loan. So for instance, you buy a vehicle from VW, so you'll find you'll get a loan. So the loan is not from the Wells Fargo or JP Morgan Bank, actually it's from VW Finance Center, because VW own a finance company. So they are using that actual money they receive by selling the commercial paper to offer you the loan. So this is a kind of company called a finance company. And the second type of the financial intermediary belong to the investment intermediaries are mutual funds. And so for the mutual fund, they are acquired funds. They are acquired funds by selling share to many individuals and then use the proceeds to purchase diversified portfolio of the stock and the bonds. So that's why you have the mutual fund. If you buy the mutual fund, you will find you've got some index, so they will combine certain share of the health stock, tech stock, so they make a fund and they sell it to you, because they acquire your fund and then they combine every investor's money to invest on this fund. And so you will get if the mutual fund price goes up, you gain more, and also for the mutual fund company as well. And third of the investment intermediaries are money market mutual fund. It's very, very similar as the mutual funds. The only difference is if you have, if you invest on the mutual money market mutual fund, you actually will be able to receive a checkbook. And so you can write check against the value of their share holdings. So that's the only difference. And the last type is called the hedge fund. So for the hedge fund, it is very, very different from the mutual fund. And the main reason is how much money you need to have in order to invest on the hedge fund. So for the hedge fund are organized as limited partners with a minimum investment ranging from $100,000 or more typically, $1 million or more. So obviously, if you invest on the hedge fund, that means you're very rich. So it's different from the mutual fund. Mutual fund is open to all investors, no matter how rich you are, how poor you are. If you have extra money, you can purchase the mutual fund, but that's not the case for the hedge fund. And so the last one I want to mention, which is not on the slides, which is also belong to the investment intermediaries, that is called investment bank. So many students have already misunderstood what an investment bank. So the investment bank, it's not like a bank, although it called banks. So actually, it is financial intermediary in the original sense. And so it actually is helping the corporation to issue the bond, so issue the security. So they are not the one acquire the funds and then lending the money out. So they're actually the one is helping the corporation to issue the fund. And so first, they will give advice to the corporation in terms of what kind of security you need to issue. Is the commercial paper or the corporate bond, etc. So they give the advice, and then they help sell the bond, the security they issued. So in this sense, we don't actually, the professional term of the sell in this case is not called sell, we call it underwrite. So underwrite. So they will underwrite the security by purchasing them from the corporation at the determined price and resell them in the market. So the investment bank also act as a deal market, deal makers, and earn enormous fees by helping corporation acquire other companies through merger and acquisition. So obviously investment bank is doing totally different kind of job than commercial banks. So you have to keep in mind. So in next video, we're going to look at the regulation on the financial markets.